In the spirit of today's episode, my shopping list includes 16 decks of playing cards, a canister of chain fuel, a bushel of dragon fruits, and a gallon of 2% milk.
What? What do you need all that stuff for?
I don't know, but it's random, isn't it?
Oh, well, that does go with the show. Or just milking the gag.
There are too many cartoons, but they'll watch them all.
The Pemmy and James Kinda-Sorta-Hopefully funny cartoon podcast.
Hello, everyone. I'm James Irish.
And I'm Pembroke W. Corgi.
Welcome once again to the Pemmy and James Kinda-Sorta-Hopefully funny cartoon podcast. And it is episode 2 of our Heckle and Jeckle month. And let's take a look at where the assorted players in our story are in 1979.
CBS decided that they wanted to bring back the Terry Toons, since they still own the rights to them, but they don't have an animation company anymore, so heck, and they want to do it on the cheap, so who'd you hire to, like, do a cartoon for you if you want it on the cheap? Filmation.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, due to CBS having a falling out with Hanna-Barbera, according to the book Animation by Filmation, Filmation was basically CBS's main supplier of cartoons in general, which kind of works out because Filmation had been kicked off of ABC thanks to the disaster of Uncle Croc's block a few years earlier.
Hysterically, they would eventually get kicked off of CBS as well, NBC and CBS as well, but wonder what Hanna-Barbera did to get CBS's ire, though.
I wish I knew. The book doesn't elaborate since, well, it's
a book about Filmation,
not Hanna-Barbera. I will continue to search that answer out, though.
I mean, there is a reason Filmation eventually went to syndication.
But yeah, CBS hadn't really done anything new with the Terry Toons properties that they purchased in 1955, since they shuttered the studio in the mid-60s. And now, if you randomly stumbled on this podcast without looking at the episode title and didn't know where this was going, congratulations! You should know now!
Yeah, CBS hired Filmation to not just bring back Heckle and Jekyll, but also bring back Mighty Mouse.
Yes, indeed. The New Adventures of Mighty Mouse and Heckle and Jekyll debuted in 1979, featuring exactly what it says on the title. A pair of original Mighty Mouse shorts, a serialized Mighty Mouse short called The Great Space Race, a pair of Heckle and Jeckle shorts, and a single short of an original Filmation creation, Quackula.
Yeah, we're going to have to talk about him someday.
He's actually next on the list.
Don't!
See? Yeah.
Oh.
In fact, we'll be tackling all of these parts individually in due time, but again, September is Heckle and Jeckle month. So we're going to start with our look at this series, this show, rather, with the Magpie Jokesters, especially since their Filmation cartoons are incredibly offbeat.
They are absolutely bonkers. Like, they are, excuse my language, but I can't think of any other phrase to say it best, batshit insane. Feel free to beep that.
I think we can get away with one or two S's.
It's just, I really can't think of any other word to describe it. And it's also kind of why I kind of like these shorts. They're not good, but they're so random and insane that every episode feels completely unpredictable.
Now, Don Christensen is handling producer duties. And of course, Lou Scheimer and Norm Prescott are the executive producers. And as for voice acting, it's Frank Welker.
Frank Welker all the way.
The Mel Blanc of television animation voices every single character you will hear in every Heckle and Jeckle short, bar perhaps one?
I think there's one that Erica Scheimer actually voices a girl, and there's one where Lou Scheimer actually voices a donkey, which seems fitting.
And don't they cross over with the...
Quackula.
Yeah.
And that episode has Theodore Bear, who's voiced by Norm Prescott, so
right.
Doing his his imitation of the guy.
This
who
came up last. This came up when we were
Botch
talking on the Hanna-Barbera tier list.
Hanna-Barbera Bunch. Joey Ross. He does Joey, like, his Ross, best Joey, yes, Ross imitation, complete with, like, ooh, ooh, I gotta get rid of that Quackula. Ooh, ooh.
Now, more on that in a couple weeks. So this series, at the very least, solidified which was Heckle and which was Jekyll, even though there were probably a couple moments in the Terrytoons that differentiated them. But this time they're given much more distinctive personalities.
Yeah, they are even given, like, distinct walk cycles, too, though those don't always stay consistent because it's Filmation.
Yeah. But to sum it up, Heckle is kind of a lovable goof-up, and Jekyll's a little saner, a little more responsible.
Definitely the smarter of the two.
Yeah. And instead of tricksters in this series of short subjects, they're basically odd jobs men.
Yeah, or just people who bungle into various situations.
Yeah. They seriously switch professions and pastimes with every short cartoon.
Yeah, they'll play a bit more everyman and heroic than, you know, how they were in the original shorts, which were tricksters and con artists.
Right. So let's dive in with our first cartoon, Safari Birds.
Safari So Goody. Oh, wait. A joke. I'm surprised they didn't make him this.
Wow. We open with a panning shot of taxidermy.
Actually, before we do that, I would like to point out who's the writer of this episode.
Okay.
This is written by Sam Simon, one of the people responsible for The Simpsons.
Oh, everybody's got to start somewhere.
Yeah, one of the Quackula episodes was written by Paul Dini, so. Wow. But yeah, no, this is Sam Simon. He became really big writing TV, and like I said, he was co-responsible for Matt Groening created the characters. He helped, put the show together, for lack of better words.
Okay, development.
Development, thank you. So yeah, that's a big name on this.
Yeah. So our short opens with a panning shot of taxidermied animal heads. Yes, including a moose. We seem to keep running into those.
The moose is loose.
And they all look rather stern for some reason, but if you were subjected to spending your post-life hanging on some collector's wall, you'd probably not be happy about it either.
And they're possibly also not happy about listening to this amazing Filmation background music this show has.
Yeah, there's something I gotta point out about this music. Who's that banging on the synthesizer?
I don't know. Maybe Lou Scheimer's nephew or something.
Anyhow, the collector is dressed as a hunter, and he explains he's the foremost collector of taxidermied animals in the world. So Heckle asks what taxidermy is, and we should just let the dialogue here speak for itself.
Taxidermy? What's that?
Stuffed animals, my friend.
You mean he sleeps with the damn things?
Wow.
Gross. No, Heckle. Ooh, gross, Heckle. Gross.
The collector says he's only missing the double-breasted seersucker. The joke being that it's a type of suit made out of thinly woven cotton. And yet, this prospect brings the animal heads to life with fright, and they bolt from behind the wall.
Man. When you're so scary, you raise the dead.
The collector wishes for Heckle and Jeckle to travel to the seersucker's lair in deepest Africa, though he calls it darkest Africa, and it's on the banks of a river.
Yeah, I think they goofed on that scene. But,
right.
Oh, well. Spent too much time drawing that very detailed hand.
Also, it's 1979, and apparently you can still call it darkest Africa.
Oof. Oof.
Yeah. So, off to the jungle, which makes this particular cartoon a good one to contrast to the approach of the original Terrytoons crew with a similarly themed lion hunt.
You know, I actually didn't think about that when I chose this episode, but you're right. My, things happen quickly in a cartoon, don't they?
Yeah, especially this one. See, Jekyll resolves to salt the bird's tail and have Heckle whack it with a mallet, which Heckle interprets as salt and battery.
Though I will at least give this scene credit for showing off their actually decently individualized walk cycles. So
true.
If you're going to repeat a walk cycle for characters, at least get, I'll forgive you if you at least give them very good individual ones that actually show off their personalities.
Agreed.
It's one of the things I do give credit to Scooby-Doo. They use those walk and run cycles a lot, but you can tell each character's personality just by those run and walk cycles.
Now, they spot the place on the map they're supposed to go, and it's literally the same topographic depiction as the map itself. Right down to the words, deep Africa, deeper Africa, deepest Africa.
I wonder if the censor note, the censor was like, you can't show darkest Africa. They just didn't change the line, but changed the picture.
Also, this gag barely has time to land before they're moving again, following the bird's tracks.
Though not as cleverly as the Terry Toon cartoon.
Not quite. Also, not as well timed, I think.
Yeah.
So the trail stops, and Heckle wonders where their quarry went.
And that's when they get stomped by Frank Welker. I mean, the double-breasted seersucker.
Yeah.
Who, of course, wears a double-breasted suit. It's like this bird is like head, suit, and like feet.
After surviving getting Goomba stomped, our protagonists follow the seersucker into the empty trunk of a tree.
This also shows when they stop getting creative with the animation individualizing them, because while they may have walk cycles and certain poses that are similar, their run cycles are the exact... Their run cycles and their kind of shocked expression before they run is like the exact same animation cell.
Mm-hmm. Finding a lamp inside the tree trunk, Jeckle decides they should search more, and out of the tree is thrown an entire apartment's worth of furniture. And even Jeckle himself, who observes, elusive creature, isn't he?
You're not going to say the really bad joke that Jeckle made when he pulled out the lamp? I want to put a little light on the subject.
Fair. Again, things are moving so quick. My notes, I kind of had to pick and choose.
That's what I'm here for.
Setting up the next gag, Jeckle uses a bird call whistle, which is just Frank Welker doing a goofy female voice calling out for the seersucker.
With lips literally just coming out of the whistle and saying, double-breasted seersucker, where are you?
The bird zooms in, and we actually hear him speak for the first time. His voice is Welker's best attempt at a Paul Winchell Tigger.
Yeah, that's a good description.
And the magpies catch it with a net, and are surprised at their luck, because, as they observe, the cartoon ain't even half over yet.
However, the seersucker just takes off the net like nothing, and then informs them that they need to have a license in order to catch seersuckers.
Yeah, Jeckle produces a dog license. So the seersucker produces a bulldog.
Sick, please!
Running away, Heckle protests that this is out of place in a jungle picture, so a lion pops up to take over the chase, to Heckle's approval.
And if you haven't finished reeling from that gag, well, guess what? We've already got another one for you.
Yeah. They're on the trail, and Heckle asks if the tracks they found are seersucker ones. Cue the train.
And a very oddly drawn flattened Heckle and Jeckle as Jeckle says, no, they are not seersucker tracks.
And their quarry laughs hysterically, and then they race up the tree where it's perched and attempt to saw the branch he's perched on. But Heckle realizes he's seen this gag before, and they all switch places.
Yeah, he's like, oh, this is one of those gags where the limb stays in the air and the tree falls.
So, cutting from the end of the limb, they fall anyway.
To which Heckle says, they just don't make cartoons like they used to.
Basically. Now, this is one of those instances where it's taking us longer to describe the cartoon than the cartoon itself goes, because they're packing a lot into this cartoon, and so few of these jokes have room to breathe because of it.
And yeah, it's all rapid fire, and it doesn't matter if they're good or bad, they just keep hitting you with them. It's kind of like, I don't know, in a way it's kind of like a precursor to what they do in a lot of 90s cartoons, except with better timing. But a lot of 90s cartoons were good at like just hitting you with gag after gag after gag, but they timed them a lot better than this show does.
Moving along, the magpies now deploy a classic pit trap, you know, with leaves covering the pit, and they hide in the recycled asset of the hollowed-out tree from earlier. Par for the Filmation course.
Yeah. The double-breasted seersucker almost falls into it, but stops in midair, just picks it up like nothing, as a cartoon would, lays it in front of the tree trunk, and then stomps on the ground to make a sound like he fell into it.
And when we say he picks it up, he picks up the facade of the cover as if it were a pile of paper or a book.
Good old portable hollow gag.
Yeah. Heckle and Jeckle spring their own trap, and Jeckle does not want Heckle to say that this is the pits.
But he does anyways.
Yeah. Now here comes probably one of the better, if not best, executed gag of the short. With Heckle hiding in a giant egg, and Jeckle sobbing, attracting the seersucker's attention.
Seersucker asks if he can help, if there's anything he can do to help poor Jeckle, and Jeckle explains that this is a abandoned double-breasted seersucker egg that has no one to hatch it. And when the seersucker asks what could he do to help, Jeckle says, "Sit on it." And he's like, "That's the least I could do."
I was waiting for him to add Potsy to that "sit on it." So when the egg starts cracking, Jeckle insists it's a 3-minute egg.
Ha.
And so Heckle launches their quarry up, and when they land, the seersucker is handcuffed.
The seersucker looks at Heckle and goes, "You don't look like a double-breasted seersucker." And
I take after my mother.
Young ones today, no respect.
And now, amplifying the randomness, here comes Tarzan!
Yep. Which it is worth mentioning that Filmation was doing a Tarzan cartoon around the same time that this show was.
Yeah. Which makes the gag of Heckle saying, "Of course I know who that is. I watch television. Ain't that Mighty Mouse?" appropriate.
Not the only Mighty Mouse reference in any of these episodes. Tarzan tells them that they have defied the laws of the jungle and must let the seersucker go. Heckle and Jeckle.
Or at least that's what we think.
Yeah.
Since we only see Tarzan and his chimpanzee companion from the back at this point.
At first, you might think it's just Filmation being cheap, but no, there's a reason for this.
Yeah, that they're actually using their reputation to do a subversion gag. Because once Heckle and Jeckle relent, we get the front view. The chimp was doing the talking, and the doofy, cross-eyed looking Tarzan admits his companion is the brains of the outfit.
That's actually a really good gag.
I will give them a lot of credit for that.
That whole scene's actually probably the best set of timed gags they did, because there's at least some breathing room before all of them, and they're actually pretty funny.
Yeah. So the hunter is disappointed, or collector, or whatever he is. But otherwise, he's satisfied in the end, because Heckle and Jeckle joined the collection as a rabbit and a moose, respectively.
Well, Frank always did want to voice Bullwinkle.
We're left at the end of the cartoon with the antlers slipping off onto Jekyll's head.
I don't even understand what this is supposed to do to help the hunter, but okay.
It doesn't solve his lack of a seersucker. But it's an ending. It's at least make some sense within the context of the cartoon, unlike the short we're going to get into after this commercial break.
The new adventures of Mighty Mouse and Heckle and Jeckle will return after these messages.
On the next Pemmy and James podcast, the magpies in today's episode were accompanied by an original Filmation creation, Quackula, not to be confused with British cult favorite Count Duckula. It's another tour de force for the ever-busy Frank Welker, as he portrays the vampiric waterfowl and all but one other character. Helps salvage our suffering as we subject ourselves to this dreck in 2 weeks.
And now, back to the new adventures of Mighty Mouse and Heckle and Jeckle.
The word of today is haberdashery.
I actually don't know what haberdashery means.
It's the shop of a hat maker.
Well, you know. I thought I just said hats.
Well, yeah, that's what the store at the front of this cartoon, Cave Bird, says. And I'll be honest, for a short with that title, I was expecting this to start in prehistoric times. But instead, we've got a modern city and we settle in on said hat store or haberdashery, as a clerk tries to get Heckle and Jeckle to actually settle on a purchase while carrying a massive number of hat boxes. Heckle is not convinced with the feather-adorned derby, and Jeckle suggests trying the hat without the feather, promptly removing it and throwing it right onto the pile of boxes.
Which causes the owner of the hat store to drop everything.
It's the inevitable straw that broke the camel's back gag, and it's made even more humiliating for the clerk when Jeckle pulls on his face thinking it's a furry hat.
Not sure how he managed to do that, but okay.
So Heckle settles on an old-fashioned straw hat, the sort we associate today with barbershop quartets. And he dances a bit with it on, and we get the gag of Heckle's mirror image dancing on its own.
Which Heckle takes shock to and then decides to just beat him at his own game and does a head spin, a jump, and the splits.
Yeah, this is some of the animation used in the show's intro, only now we get its full context.
Yep, the mirror just looks at that those moves and just shakes its head no and poofs out of existence, which, I mean, considering he ended on the splits, yeah, I can't blame the mirror on that.
Right. And still, I was thinking this gag would somehow lead to the plot.
Nope.
But the hat's $10. And then Heckle haggles it down to $5 and then free, because the clerk is desperate to just get rid of them.
To the point to where he just gives it to them for free, kicks them out of the shop, and closes down for the day.
So as Heckle's admiring the hat, a gust of wind sends it sailing down the street and around the corner into a history museum as the magpies give pursuit.
They get right into the history museum, and then there's that random, they stop, and then that, like, shock response that they do a close-up of on Heckle that just is weirdly animated better than most of the animation in this show. And then they find that the hat has landed on a mummy.
Yeah, Heckle jumps onto the mummy to grab the hat, wakes the mummy up, leading to a mummy's curse that... Wait, no, this isn't how we get to the premise either.
No. But he at least apologized for waking him up.
Yeah. Also, I should mention their run cycle animation is accompanied by the sound of somebody wobbling a sheet of, something?
Aluminum, maybe?
Maybe. Judge for yourself from this sound effect, folks. And now, Heckle and Jeckle collide trying to catch the hat, and the animation of their collision... Pemmy, this one's all you.
God, I don't even know how to explain this animation.
Yeah, that's why I gave the description to you. Because I don't either.
They run into each other. They kind of merge into one being, shoot off the sides of the screen, and then land on their asses from the ceiling despite, you know, being sent sideways. It's indescribable.
Yeah.
And I also say they do repeat this animation in multiple episodes. Because of course they do.
Of course.
If you really want to see what this animation looks like, I'm pretty sure I uploaded it somewhere on my WTF Cartoons Twitter. So
the hat eventually lands on a statue of a cave dog. And as Heckle and Jeckle race up to it, there's a sudden flash. And the dogs are no longer statues.
They're actually alive.
Yeah, the sudden appearance of a triceratops is enough to clue in the viewers that Heckle and Jeckle have just randomly been drawn into the land before time with little rhyme or reason, when frankly they had two lovely opportunities to do it beforehand.
I don't know if the show is purposely trying to be subversive or just doing it all by accident. The triceratops gets upset about not getting the caveman he was chasing and starts crying.
Yeah, this is after the caveman zip up the entrance to their cave.
Which causes Heckle to pull out a... I mean, it causes Jeckle to pull out an umbrella to protect them from the crying that is so massive it's practically rain, only for Jeckle to point out that umbrellas haven't been... Or Heckle to point out that umbrellas haven't been invented yet, to which Jekyll's like, are you sure? And the umbrella pops out of existence, and... He's like, I'm sure.
Wow. They went from the statues are alive to I don't think umbrellas have been invented yet in record time.
They try to persuade the Triceratops by throwing it a bone, and it plays catch with them, but end up trampling them by jumping directly on top of them.
Heckle tries calling on a phone about a lost dinosaur. Jeckle should have just countered, those haven't been invented either.
But, you know, I like how they went from umbrellas haven't been invented yet to just pulling out a freaking telephone.
And at this point, a woman comes up to take the Triceratops home, referring to him as Dino.
I wonder if the Flintstones can sue.
Hmm. Also, yes, this woman is Frank Welker.
Yes. Also, this woman looks like she's an actual woman and not an animal character like everybody else.
Yeah. But we get back to the hat story in the zipped-up cave at this point.
Yep. Heckle and Jeckle say that they're there to check the meters, which also shouldn't be invented yet.
And once they get in, they're presented with the endgame sequence of Let's Make a Deal. Incoming rule of three gag.
Let's see. Who's the first monster?
Door number one is a saber-toothed tiger.
Door number two is snakes. Why has it got to be snakes?
And door number three is a bunny rabbit. Wait, nope. The rabbit is unzipping its outfit, and it turns out to be a monster of indeterminate species. Because it's so big, all we can see is its head.
It's Pac-Man's illegitimate cousin. Either that or someone saw Monty Python.
So escaping from that trio of terrors, they get the hat off a caveman watching, cave dog watching TV.
Which somehow is invented.
Yeah.
But umbrellas aren't.
In their escape, Heckle draws a door on the cave. And, you know, you think this is how they're going to get out, but it turns out all he drew was a closet.
Yep. The cave dogs try to open it, only for them to immediately exit, slamming the door on top of them.
Mm-hmm.
And again, credit, that's at least, as far as drawing the door gags go, that's somewhat different than usual.
And next, they find a river underground, and Jeckle uses Heckle as a jet ski.
Yeah, we don't see that very much this is the only time we see this in the episodes we're watching, but that's actually a running gag, is Jeckle using Heckle as various objects, from like surfboard, mallet, dousing rod.
Boy, what a way to consider your friend a tool. The dogs, meanwhile, lose the trail for a bit, since one wants to surf on another, and they're both too heavy for that.
I think what they did is they saw what Heckle and Jeckle were doing and decided to try to do that too, but didn't work out for them.
Complete with a modern captain's hat.
So our heroes, if you want to call them that, find a lava-based elevator and the buttons, which has an animation of either Heckle or Jeckle being excessively excited about finding those buttons.
I'm assuming it's Jeckle, because at this point, Heckle has the hat back.
You know, that's a fair point. It's still a really random animation.
Yeah, he's just ecstatic. You'd think he won the lottery.
So they push the up arrow, jump on the rock that's on this lava spout, and have it shoot them up through a volcano?
Yeah. Also, convection? What's that?
The cave dogs hit the down button in hopes to stopping Heck and Jack, but instead it just causes the rock platform they're on to land on all the cave dogs, who weirdly happy about this.
Also, at this point, the lava really starts coming through. And Heckle and Jekyll are just suspended in midair, and they dash with their legs to escape the volcano. Did they forget their magpies?
There's actually one or two episodes that do actually have them fly, but 90% of the time, yes, they seem to forget this, because there's one episode where they're male birds, and like Heckle like says, "I feel like a bird," while they're in like an airplane. He's like, "I feel like a bird," and then he gets hit with a duck. He's like, "I said I feel like a bird. I didn't say I wanted a bird." And I'm like, or I wanted the bird, ha. But I'm just like, dude, you are a bird.
Of course, to quote one of the instances where we do see them fly, what happened?
But I think Yeah, that's from the surfing episode. I think that's my favorite delivery Frank gives in this entire series, is the, what happened?
So with no explanation, we're back in the museum with the painting of the volcano erupting, and Heckle and Jeckle are on the floor.
Heckle's proud about having his hat, but another mysterious gust of wind. God, this is... Where the hell are they if it's so windy?
Chicago?
Thank you. Maybe, we found out Heckle and Jeckle takes place in Chicago. But the wind blows the hat onto a knight in shining armor's joust.
Yeah, a lance, I believe.
Lance, thank you. I wonder if that...
Just as it seems they're about to... Sorry.
I was going to say, I wonder if that lance is named Walter.
Oh. But just as it seems they're about to start all over again, Jeckle flips a switch. You want a hat? Have some hats.
And they get, and a ton of hats just fall on them out of effing nowhere.
Yeah. Cue the everybody laughs ending. So, I want to preface this, my postscript criticism of this show, by saying, when I was a kid, I read this gigantic book on animation. I forget who wrote it, but in the Looney Tunes chapter, when they were describing Bob McKimson's work, he criticized it as cartoon business as usual. Not entirely fair to McKimson, when that really describes a lot of the Terry Toons output to a T.
Yeah, I think McKimson is underrated. He created Taz, for God's sakes.
Right.
And Foghorn Leghorn.
Yeah. But compared to what Filmation came up with for Heckle and Jeckle, it's like they had a fire sale on cartoon business as usual, and every gag must go.
Like I said earlier, this is not a good show, but I kind of love it just because of how absolutely nuts it is and how they just literally throw, you know, it's a case where, you know, most shows is like we throw everything at the wall and see what sticks. This one, they just throw everything at the wall and put it in.
And shoot it out one of those tennis ball launchers at full speed.
It kind of makes it amazing. I do want to say one thing that I am legitimately surprised by. I'm actually legit surprised that Filmation used their did a take on the original designs for Heckle and Jeckle rather than using the late era, more stylized designs. Because I figured they would have jumped at the later Terry Toon, more stylized designs because they would have been easier to animate. But
now the following season, the show was cut down to a half-hour format, with just one Heckle and Jeckle cartoon in the rotation. And this would be the duo's last starring vehicle of any length beyond a single pilot.
Are we going to talk about that pilot?
In a quick moment, because they did make a very brief, silent cameo in 1988's Mighty Mouse The New Adventures.
Oh, I actually didn't know that.
Yeah. And then in 1999, we get that pilot, Curbside.
It's interesting. I don't know if you've watched it before.
I did, on one of your streams.
Okay, I didn't know if you're in that stream or not. It's interesting. Very odd.
Yeah, to start, this pilot assigns Toby Huss as Jeckle in a reprisal of his voice he gave to Bushroot of Darkwing Duck fame. And Bobcat Goldthwait is Heckle.
Boy, that's a choice. Let's see. But yeah, Bobcat Goldthwait is such a strange choice. But yeah, in it, Heckle and Jeckle are now talk show hosts that host at the curbside of some street.
Yeah.
And it includes some other Terry Toon characters, like their sidekick is Dinky Duck.
And the house band are the Mighty Heroes.
Which, hey, I'm props for that because I actually like the Mighty Heroes. That's one of the few things I remember about the 88 Mighty Mouse cartoon? Hmm. Or was it 86? I can't remember.
Either way, the talk show is a framing device for new cartoons featuring the other Terry Toon properties, and they go all over the place.
Yep, we to get pull from. We get Deputy Dog, Tom Terrific, Mighty Mouse. seemingly Gene Deitch was not very... Seemingly Gene Deitch saw this pilot and was not happy with how they portrayed Top Terrific in it.
I wonder how he reacted to his other contribution to that era, that elephant fellow.
Seemingly, I didn't hear anything about how he felt about that. All I remember is the only thing I heard was that he didn't like how they used Tom Terrific. It was Sidney the elephant. But yeah, the pilot wasn't picked up, and which is a pity because Viacom owns these characters and I'd like to see them do something with them.
Truthfully, it would take a pretty radical new concept for them to be brought back. Curbside could have done it at the time. But today, the moment for a talk show parody is kind of come and gone since the late night ratings war between Jay Leno and David Letterman is a thing of the past.
Yeah, and I mean, you can't top Space Ghost Coast to Coast, let's be honest.
That too.
But yeah, Curbside, when I watched that pilot, my response was, this is weird. I'm not sure if I like this or not, but I would still be interested in seeing another episode to see where it goes.
We will eventually review Curbside as well, because all together now, it's on the list.
But now these characters are just in the Paramount Viacom vault, sitting around rotting and doing nothing. Could put them on Paramount Plus. You've got a streaming service.
In the meantime, you can find almost anything Heckle and Jeckle easily on YouTube.
Yeah, though not all of the episodes of the Filmation one are available online as of yet. So I guess this means that show's partial lost media?
Partial. Perhaps someday.
Yeah, which is weird because I don't know when, but at some point, like 10 years ago or something, the Filmation ones were appearing on random cable channels. Hmm. I got familiarized with this show because when I was a kid, there was a local channel in Ardmore, Oklahoma, that just played random weird stuff. And this was one of the things that came up. And immediately when I saw it, this was before I fully knew who Filmation was, but just looking at the animation, I was like, oh God, these are the guys who made the weird Tom and Jerry cartoon.
Oh.
But I ended up liking it then, and I still kind of like it now. Like I said, it's not good, but I just like how just insane it is. When you see a lot of shows in this, especially in the 70s era, it feels nice to have a show that, even if it's not good, it at least manages to surprise you.
In the meantime, it's time to go restock the breakfast cereal.
All right. See ya!
Have a good night, everyone.
The Pemmy and James Kinda-Sorta Hopefully Funny Cartoon Podcast!
The preceding podcast is a co-production of the Mighty Monkey Corporation and Artificial Orange Studios. The theme song is written, composed, and performed by Sean Michael Smith.